by four incredible practitioners, thinkers, as Eric would say, catalyzers of these ideas. I'm going to introduce them now. To my immediate left is Ifrah Abshir, who is a senior in high school at Rainier Beach High School here in Seattle. A lot of fans.
Go Vikings.
Ifrah is a newspaper editor and a published writer, and among her many accomplishments addressing inequality include working to obtain ORCA cards, which is a public transportation card here, for low-income students living far from school, organizing Islamophobia Awareness Day, and she's also been active in restorative justice practices in her high school, and she's going to speak about that in a moment. To Ifrah's left is Matthew Burman, who is a re-engagement specialist for Highline Public Schools, also here. Highline is a school dedicated to revamping school discipline by eradicating suspension for the poor choices that students make and using in-school discipline instead. And he's going to speak about that. To Matthew's left, can I call you Matt? Matt, okay. To Matt's left is Keith Hickman. He's a restorative justice expert, and I would say we would call him an ambassador for restorative justice, having taught these methods and practices across the United States and in Jamaica. One thing that's interesting about Keith is in 2000, he helped to found the Youth Justice Project at the Harlem Community Justice Center in partnership with the Center for Court Innovation. And I've done a lot of work with the Center for Court Innovation, so that's sort of the gold standard, I think, of restorative justice practices. And last and certainly not least is Nikkita Oliver, who is a lawyer and a poet, and I hope most of you, or all of you, actually, had the chance to, and were lucky enough to engage with her work last night. Nikita's work is actually a bridge between this panel and the last panel, and that she brings the arts to the center of her organizing work against racism and promoting what I would consider to be a very deep and broad vision of justice. So that's our panel. And we are going to start and by diving into the conversation right now. I'm going to start with Ifrah. And Ifrah, I think it would be great if you could just tell us in the audience a bit about the work you've done in restorative justice in your high school. We want to start by opening the conversation about practices on the ground before we start by before we can build a scaffold for understanding it in a more abstract way.
Like Tracey mentioned before, I had the chance and the privilege of working on the ORCA card program for low-income students at my school. Initially, it was just for students at my school because I go to Rainy Beach High School, which is over 90% students of color, and of that 90%, over 70 are on fee-and-reduced lunch. So fee-and-reduced lunch, lunch costs $1.50 every day. So if these students were not expected to pay that much, why were they expected to pay $3 getting transportation to and back from school? Right, so it just didn't make sense to me, you know. That was one of the reasons why my school had a really low attendance rate, and that's why we didn't get a lot of funding. So it was this whole cycle of issues that really just started with that inequality at the base. So we had met with like people in power, like we met with city officials, we met with the school board, we even had like word from the governor's office. And at the end of the whole 2-year fight, we had got a grant from the city, $1 million grant to provide ORCA cards for kids on fee and reduced lunch in the whole city. The whole city. And then the second thing I've really done is Islamophobia Awareness Day. I won't really go deep into it because that's like a whole can of worms itself, but we just realized that a lot of our community, our school was people of Islamic faith, you know, and a lot of recent immigrants from other places, to realize they were really being targeted not only because of their color but because of their religion. So it was like this two-layer cake that we tried to unravel by having that day at Pike Place Market, which is in Seattle. And that's kind of what I did in the past. And what we're currently doing right now, which I invite all you guys to come to on, if you're still here, on March 24th at Rainy Beach, we're having our second annual Social Justice Day. And last year's was based off of like the whole damage that was being done to black bodies, so like the general concept of it. This year we kind of specified it and talked about Hamza Wasame, which probably everybody in this room does not know about, but Hamza was a Rainier Beach student. he was a close family friend of mine. And on September 5th of this year, he's a Running Star student, so he went with one of his classmates, which is an older 23-year-old white male, to his apartment to study. He had texted his mom. He said, "Mom, I'm at this address. I'm going to be here for a couple hours studying." 3 hours later, he was found dead. And he was a Rainier Beach student. You know, he was a Running Star student. And immediately, the police ruled a suicide. They said that he had fell off of the top of the guy's apartment building. He had fell off. It was a suicide. And that, everybody at Rainier Beach, after hearing that, his family, every student, was immediately outraged. Because first off, suicide is not something that you throw around as an excuse for what could happen. That's a separate issue itself. And also, this was a student who had a lot of potential, who was doing Running Star, who was an active leader in the religious community. And this is 3 days after the past shooting. I forgot the name of it, but it was another shooting by this in a school by this person who said the Islamic faith. You know, so there was this whole a lot of Islamic ridicule, and the police were telling us that it had no correlation. Like, he was not, it was a suicide. It had no correlation because of his faith, because of his color, because of who he was. And we would not accept it. So this year, we kind of focus all social justice there on Hamza and how do we harness that passion in positive ways, you know? Because I think that, in a sense, is what restorative justice is. We are harnessing the anger that you get and putting in positive ways, building that connection between the victim and the victimizer, in a sense.
Before I turn to Matt to talk about his work, Ifrah, I'd like you, if you can, to follow up on the incredible your description of the incredible activities you've been involved in your high school, with some, you know, some thoughts, some ideas about how it is that you have found the space to do that. Is this about peer support? Is it about leadership of adult leadership in your school, facilitating that, getting out of your way? Someone from Mikvah's Challenge mentioned last night that one of the most important things you can do is just get out of kids' way and let them lead. If you could just say a little bit about that, I think that would be helpful to folks in the room.
I think for me, specifically, how I got involved in a lot of this is just putting me out of my own context, right? Getting out of my comfortable zone and realizing that it's beyond just me, right? I'm just one voice, but there's millions of others who are silenced, right? And it's my duty, it's my responsibility as a citizen to be responsible for speaking for others who cannot speak, especially because I have the power to speak, right? And then on top of that, I guess at a high school level, what got my high school really involved, and also what got me involved was we had the privilege of having freedom schools. I will always refer back to freedom schools. I am like, I'll pitch freedom schools all day to you if I could. But so we have a Children's Defense Fund freedom school site at Rainier Beach, and actually some of our teachers are over there. But freedom schools is kind of what really gave students at Rainier Beach the platform to speak about these issues, because they had all this anger, this incitement, but they didn't really have a platform to talk, right? Nobody was giving them a mic and saying, "Here, talk," right? Nobody was doing that for these kids, and freedom schools did that. So I think just that, having that space, and I would encourage all you guys to adopt freedom schools. Just plug it.
Thank you.
First off, Ifrah, I'd say thanks, because I know at least a couple of students that have Orca cards and definitely benefit from them, so thank you very much. A couple of my students in the middle school just south of Rainier Beach, will move unexpectedly, and we want them to stay at our school, and one of the ways that we get them to do that is through the program that you mentioned. The work that we've got going on at Highline started with essentially looking at graduation rates and trying to dig into the numbers and saying, you know, who's not graduating and why. The numbers were pretty stark, and if you have a single out-of-school suspension, doesn't matter when it is, sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, it drastically reduces the likelihood that you will eventually graduate. Okay. So the superintendent a couple years ago funded, which is pretty rare, a position at a school that was essentially a restorative justice coordinator. It's not quite that. You know, it depends on the school you're at. It's an in-school suspension director or teacher. But as it's been implemented, we're realizing that that person is the person in the school that has the flexibility and the, you know, the ability to build those relationships and to facilitate those conversations. So the design was really, you know, to build an empathy-based in-school suspension that was an alternative to like the Breakfast Club model of in-school suspension. If you end up spending a couple of days in my classroom, it's going to be a lot of academics, but we'll spend half the time, you know, do 25-minute chunks of academics, a five-minute break, 25 minutes of what I call study skills, but they're social emotional learning, backpack organization, goal setting, strengths assessments, that type of thing. The real idea is, you know, kind of thinking back to what Robert said in the last panel, it's to be a person that's not providing the answers, but that's asking the right questions. I try to really clearly at the beginning say, I don't know what the right way for you to be a student is. I don't know what your strengths are, but I hope to build a space and a structure where you can reflect on yourself. And you know, again, in the last panel, Damien mentioned that the intervention really starts with empathy and curiosity. And so it really surprises a student when they walk in thinking they're about to get punished. And they have to spend 2 days in this punishment room where the person that they find is just really curious and really asking a lot of questions and pushing them and, you know, trying to hold them accountable. But that comes much later and much less. I don't talk a whole lot about what they did wrong until we sit down with the people that were harmed. And then really try and bring in families as well. So you'll usually spend 2 days in-school suspension. Probably your family will show up the second day or be on speakerphone. Maybe if there was a fight, you know, there will be the mediation and that type of thing, which we can talk more about. But it really is about bringing people together, families included. And what we've found is that we've been lucky to have a low recidivism rate. We were worried even that having a comforting environment with, you know, a couch and an open and empathetic guy and, you know, 5 minutes of break time every 25 minutes that students would want to get back. You know, where it's like, oh my goodness, they're going to start misbehaving just to get back into in-school suspension. And we've actually, it was a big concern actually. we found the opposite though. They do stop by and I do follow-up meetings with them. But the recidivism rate is actually really low, which is pretty exciting.
So Matt, the social scientist in me wants to know a little bit more about exactly how low that recidivism rate is.
The student I'm working with on Monday has a very high amount of recidivism. So it is not non-existent. I think the last time we checked the data, it was, you know, out of, I don't know, 50 suspensions, three had returned or something like that.
That's thinking good.
Off the top of my head.
So Keith, I thought it might be nice at this point as the restorative justice expert to sort of take it up a level. We've heard two examples, actually multiple examples, because Ifrah offered some different ideas about different things going on at Rainier. If you could give a sense of the kind of work you do, but also, you know, direct those comments to more of an analysis of what you see in the programs that we've just heard about and how it resonates with the restorative justice practices that you teach across the country.
First of all, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Eric, CitizenU. And I particularly want to thank Committee for Children for hosting IRP and inviting us to this wonderful conference. And at the work that we're doing in terms of integrating and breaking down silos across the education reform movement is huge. So I'll start with just adding some more weight to this. I'm the director of continuing education for the Institute, International Institute for Restorative Practices, and the Institute itself is the only graduate school in the country that offers a master's in science and a graduate certificate in restorative practices. So that's pretty big in and of itself. What we're aiming to do is we are an emerging social science that is studying how to build social capital and how to achieve social discipline through participatory learning and decision making. The hypothesis of what we're trying to present and test is that people are most likely and happier and willing to be productive and cooperative when those in position of authority do things with them rather than to them or for them. So what we've created is we created a whole framework of support systems that we teach, train, and push out across various sectors, including education, the criminal justice system, organizational leadership, social services, and family engagement and family work. And that's really important. So to conceptualize this, it is an actual movement across the country now that we are pushing more and more zero tolerance policy out the door. So in my role and in my work, to just add more light to it, last year we trained over 10,000 people in restorative practices. What does that equal in terms of the transformation that's happening across the country? Is if you look at places like Los Angeles Unified School District, Oakland with RJOY, Chicago, every urban area, and recently half the schools in Pittsburgh under a DOJ grant in partnership with Rand Corps, you're seeing enormous shifts and changes in the climate in terms of the reduction of suspensions and building equity across the board in terms of resources and what's happening in schools. So in terms of data points and what we've been able to see, in the schools that implement restorative practices at a high fidelity rate, and high fidelity meaning that they're doing all the essential elements and all the work on a consistent and explicit basis, and it's a part of the fabric of the school and the district, those schools have seen decreases in suspensions and increases in school climate change, so decreases in suspensions as much as 80 to 90% in about a year or two. And the important piece to that is it's not just restorative practices, but it's the integration of the framework, the very body of restorative practices, into the other programs that are already existing in schools like social emotional learning. So one of the themes that I want to continue to carry with me across the country is it's really important that we begin to break down silos and begin to integrate this work. When I go into schools and we talk about restorative practices, one of the first things that comes out of teachers and principals' mouths are, I don't have time to do another program. Oh, it's another program. It's the flavor of the month, which is true. So time and space are two things that schools are struggling with. And so I'll give you an example. When I do trainings and I ask a group of folks in the room, how many times do you come together to have these kinds of conversations, even discuss this? Oftentimes they'll tell me it's the first time they've ever gathered as a staff. So what that tells me is we're not creating time and space for educators and professionals to come together to support each other. And what's happening is if we don't do that work, we're creating and contributing to a climate of blame and shame. And a climate of blame and shame is directly impacting and making its way down into the classroom and impacting our students. So we talk about the numbers of suspension. Actually, a good friend of mine, Henry McClendon, who works for Skillman Foundation, he says, we have a suspension problem, but what's more important is we have a relationship problem. And that's what restorative practices focuses on, building and rebuilding relationships.
So it sounds like the ideas that you think are important obviously are happening in the Highline schools, and whether I'm less sure about what's happening in Rainier Beach other than they have the magical U, so that's really critical, and not everybody gets to have Ifrah. Maybe Nikkita, you could, you know, connect up with those ideas in terms of, you know, the different strategies that we can do to open up the kind of space that Keith says is necessary to get these practices done. Maybe some of your work in the arts is a pathway to that.
Yeah, so I want to first lay out a little bit of what the context is like here in Seattle, because I think people watch us nationally and are like, Seattle's so progressive. And I'm like, as compared to what? You know, the measuring stick matters, right? And so here, Looking at both ends of the spectrum of the school to prison pipeline, we have a school district that has been under investigation for a number of years, Seattle Public Schools, for racial disproportionality and disparate impact in school exclusion policies. And so at schools like Rainier Beach, where Ifrah's at, there are community organizers who have purposely decided that's a school we're going to work with because there's students like Ifrah and there are faculty that want to partner to learn these practices. And so in conjunction with grassroots community members, with students, with faculty, with administration, we started doing trainings with RJOY, Restorative Justice Oakland, Restorative Justice Oakland Youth, which is great. They came up, they did some trainings with us around peace circles, and we got to learn what does a peacemaking circle look like. And we started doing those with different communities, and then started doing them within Rainier Beach between students and faculty and staff. And that started opening the door for having the conversation about getting restorative justice into our schools. So the other end of it is Seattle's also trying to build a new youth jail. And Seattle keeps saying, well, we have fewer youth in detention. And so then my next question is, well, why do we need a new jail if we have fewer youth in detention? You go look at those numbers, and while there might be fewer youth in detention, there's actually more black and brown youth in detention, more black and brown youth who are then being moved to adult court. And so we can see that the school to prison pipeline that targets mostly black and brown youth from school to the prison is still working here. And so that leads to the work that I do with Creative Justice, which is an arts-based alternative to incarceration. And part of our goal is to first acknowledge that we have a system that is built to purposely target certain people, black and brown people and poor people. And it built itself. It's literally built itself on using those people, using those humans, to sustain a capitalistic model that started in slavery. And so in acknowledging that, we know that when black and brown youth and poor youth go into the courts, and when white youth go into the courts, they don't get treated the same way. White youth often get diversion, because for the way we look at each other, we think that white youth will be able to turn it around in diversion. And for some reason, we think that black and brown youth and poor youth need to be jailed in order to turn it around. But we know, all the data tells us, that jailing young people does not work. It's retributive, it seeks restitution, it seeks everything that's opposite of what restorative justice tries to do. And because it's built in capitalism, it means, and white supremacy and patriarchy, it means it's a moneymaker. So now we have for-profit prisons and jails and lobbyists that say we want to keep fighting for these jails, even though we know restorative practices work. So I am going to bring this full circle eventually. Y'all are like, where is she going? When I think about what we're doing with restorative justice through creative justice, I have one critique of us, which is in order for youth to get this opportunity for restorative justice through our project, they have to become court involved. And that's a problem, right? So I want to put that out there up front. But what we do seek to do is to restore balance. Restorative justice means that we think about the victim or the person harmed, as well as the person who did the harm, holistically. We have to acknowledge that while people commit individual acts, those acts are committed within a system of privilege and oppression that forces people to make very hard decisions. And when we're talking about young people whose brains are going to continue to develop until they're 25, white youth and rich youth get the opportunity to make mistakes with a net that works. And that means that when they make a mistake, we strive to restore them back to the community. We strive to not simply address the harm, but also acknowledge maybe that harm came from somewhere. Maybe it started somewhere else. Maybe they harmed this other person because someone else had harmed them. So restorative justice means looking at the responsibility and the accountability of the whole community and not just the singular individual. I think that we live in a society that not only is based upon money, and likes to do those things that make money, but we're based in a society that utilizes efficiency and functionalism as a reason for why we continue doing things that we know does not work. The courts are something we've been using for a long time to try to deal with punishment. What we know about young people is, and what we know about most people is, most humans, is that punishment actually is not what changes behavior. Incentives do. And so the court system is not incentivized for the person we're saying committed the harm. In fact, we've actually built our courts to be incentivized for people who make money. And so I think we have to start asking ourselves about why we continue to use a system that in the data, because I know some people like them numbers, and the data tells us does not work, but when we listen to the data that Keith just gave us, it's very clear that restorative justice practices do work. I also think we have to ask ourselves about the values we place on different people. Restorative justice seeks to create a balanced playing field. When you sit in a peacemaking circle, the administrator or the adult is not more valuable than the youth. In fact, everybody's voice is valued. We use a talking piece. And you don't get to talk out of turn. You have to wait till it comes to you. You have to really listen. And so I think we have to start transforming the ways in which we value young people to see that they're also dignified. They also have thought processes. They have reasons for why they did what they did. And addressing harms that happen in community actually require listening a lot more than it requires punishment.
So I'd like to connect up what Nikkita just said to some social science research, which I actually think allows us to take it up a little bit more. And then this is also going to give you guys a chance to think about something, so I'm going to filibuster for a little bit. And then from there, what I'd like to do is ask you about the things that make it difficult. So here's the social science. And it turns out, I think, that what Nikkita says is exactly right, that people don't obey the law because they fear the consequences of failing to do so. They typically obey the law either because they think it's the right thing to do or because they think government has the right to tell them what to do, and they voluntarily comply with the law. This is the social psychology of procedural justice, and that's been the focus of my research for the last 20 years or so. And four things are really important, each of which I think is reflected in what all of you have said, either collectively or individually. People really care about being treated with dignity and respect. That's one way they understand that they've been treated fairly. They care about being able to tell whether decisions are fair, that they're transparent or neutral, that it's been explained to them why someone in authority, whether it's a teacher, a police officer, a judge, is doing what they're doing. People really care about being able to tell their side of the story, having voice and input, whether in a particular interaction. I think that's clearly evident with the work that you've done, Ifrah, that you know the youth just have had this opportunity to make clear what is important to them. And that's true, people care about this, whether or not it makes a difference to the outcome. And fourth, people look for the opportunity to assess whether the person in authority that they're dealing with, that whether they can expect to be treated benevolently by them in the future. Now that one's a tough one, because it often has to deal with all of these aspects that especially you, Nikkita, were talking about. If I'm a member of a group that's been historically oppressed, even if I've never dealt with a police officer in my life, and I know that that police officer or teacher or judge has treated someone in my group poorly in the past, there's no reason for me to expect to be treated benevolently by that person, and I'm going to mistrust them. And if you are a person who has been historically advantaged by, you know, those same people, then of course you're going to expect that to happen. So, you know, the work that we've done, at least in the policing context, has been to try to come up with strategies to change how, you know, the kinds of people, groups, students, youth that you've been working with, view, you know, the schools and other people that they deal with. But here's what I think is really hard, at least for me personally. You know, the kinds of things that you do when you're engaging in restorative practices, you know, trying to change how people view the people they're interacting with, is sometimes difficult for me because of the kind of work that in the last panel, Davida Ingram was talking about. And she, I'm just gonna pose this question again. She says, you know, how do we ask white people to give up whiteness and love ourselves all the way through? I can ask that question in the work that I do. You know, how do I work with groups like school officials, like law enforcement officials, to change how they treat the people that I love? you know, the people that are people who I am, and love myself all the way through, when sometimes I just feel like what I should be doing is saying, you know, you shouldn't be trying to do this at all. You know, we should give up. And I'm sure that each one of you has had a struggle like that. And so if you would be willing to share, I would love to hear, and I think maybe some folks in the audience might too.
Anyone? I'll jump in real quickly. I think we have to approach this in terms of a learning organization. Let's contextualize it. A school is a learning organization. A criminal justice setting could be a learning organization. So if you contextualize it in terms of a learning organization, within a learning organization, there is the there is a framework that must be in place, and that framework breaks out into four quadrants. The four quadrants are, and this is the social discipline window, so going back to what I talked about, the fundamental hypothesis, the four quadrants are to, for, not, with. It's a box, to, for, so that framework is how we want to have relationship. So if you think about to, which is the default, that's how most people in positions of authority operate under, and that's punitive. If you think about for, that's permissive. If you think about not, that's cosmetic. And if you think about with, it's the with box that those in position of authority should be operating under. So the way I answer this question is this. It is incredibly challenging, but it's quite possible, and it is happening. And the way it happens is it has to be done with implementation science. We have to start talking about restorative justice and practices as not just some cognitive thing, and not just some feel-good thing, although it does make us feel good and it is cognitive. We have to drill it down to the pedagogy and the practice and the sharing of those practices in small spaces, in communities. So it's not enough just to respond to harm, but you have to be proactive and build community at the same time. Because if you build social capital, then you created the relationships for when harm is done and when mistakes are made, which they happen. We're human, we make mistakes. We separate the behavior from the intrinsic value of individuals, then we could restore and repair and reintegrate people back into the community. And this is where we have a disconnect. So it really requires high levels of implementation, pedagogy, practice, time, space, all of that, which has been designed and done and happening in schools that do it well.
So I just want to go ahead. Yeah, y'all clap. Yeah. Give love. Love is good. Build relationship. Something I struggle with is we talk about restorative justice. Justice should be restorative, right? When people get out of jail, they cannot be restored. We have a whole system that's set up to make sure you can't get a job, can't get a house. If you can't do those things, you're probably going to go back, right? And you don't get all your rights back, because we don't actually believe that jails work. Because if we did, when people got out, we'd welcome them back home. We don't think that you've been restored. So that's one problem. I think that you bring up police is really interesting, because the young people I work with do not like police. And the police don't like them either. Now, do the police admit that? Sometimes. But not usually. And so I think what is powerful about restorative practices is that what first has to happen is the people involved in the conversation have to admit their true feelings for each other. They have to admit the ways in which they actually don't like each other or have dehumanized each other. If we can't start with the truth, we can't get to restoration. So I think that's what's powerful about what's been happening in schools like Rainier Beach is a student can sit down in a circle with a teacher and say, I don't like you. And the teacher can say, I don't like you either. And then if we can start there, then maybe we can actually understand what the problem is in the classroom. And maybe it comes out in that circle, the reason the student doesn't like that teacher is because they remind them too much of someone who harmed them another time. And now what we're talking about is trauma-informed care. We're talking about the responses that we build up because of our experiences that are actually quite beautiful, because our bodies are built to survive. which is beautiful, but what it means for those of us who've experienced trauma with the system or trauma by police or trauma by courts or teachers or someone before that is we get these ingrained responses that are not wrong. They're actually quite right. How do we help young people figure out how to use those responses in a healthy way to identify? Right now, I feel like responding to this teacher the way I did to my dad when I put my fist through the wall, and I'm not quite sure where that comes from, but I can identify it now. And so I can maybe stop and say to that teacher, yo, teach, I'm feeling really unsafe. And I feel like putting my fist through the wall like I did last week, and I don't want to do that. And a teacher who acknowledges the dignity of a student and their response and their ability to be aware of their emotions and identify that is gonna say, you know what, I respect that. And the teacher might even say, you know what, I'm feeling a little triggered myself right now. And both can then maybe call someone like Matt here and say, hey Matt, we need to take a break in the classroom, and we're wondering if after school you can help us sit down and talk about this. Now there's a lot that has to be unpacked before you can get there first, and you have to accept that young folks are young folks for a reason. We are trying to learn how to process our emotions like young people everywhere always have. So as teachers and people who have been given some power and authority, we also need to be receptive and responsive to that. And I think that's what's powerful about restorative practices.
And I'll just also, I mean, this, the same things that work for you as adults, and I mean, look at the power in this room. If we took the tables out and you sat in circles, we put you in triads, and the energy, the reason why this is so powerful is because of affect psychology. It's interest and engagement and excitement, and we want to live in the positive affect. But when we shame and humiliate, which is one of the six negative affects, we shame and humiliate, which happens all the time in schools with students and among staff and with principals in districts, you know, and in courts, and people experience shame and humiliation all the time. We only have but four ways to respond to that. We attack self, we attack other, we withdraw. You know, so we go to this compass of shame and we can't get off that compass of shame. That's why in classrooms, when students are having a difficult time and the teacher, let's say the student gets at the teacher, may curse him or her out, is sent out, because maybe that teacher put that student in a shameful situation, their response was to attack other. And then now that teacher is feeling hurt. And what happens in schools without a restorative ethos is those two are left alone. So when that student comes back to the classroom, if they even get back to the classroom, the trigger default because of that harm has been caused is, you do one thing to step out of line, I'm gonna use my authority ungracefully. And I'm going to kick you back out again, and to a point where they're put into the school to prison pipeline. So this is really critical in terms of understanding that these practices have to be done explicitly. It's not just conceptually, they have to be done explicitly. And the same things that work for us in this room are the same spaces we need to create for them in school.
So Matt, how do we get more of these schools like yours, right? Where we're not, you know, stuck in this shaming cycle, but instead engaged in a restorative, healthy, helpful cycle?
I appreciate the question, but I don't want to say that we've got it. I think, you know, from where we are to where we want to go, I'm thinking 2 out of 10, you know?
Okay.
You know, Tracey, you talked about opening up spaces. Keith talked about, you know, doing things to versus with, you know, having a pedagogy of practice. I kind of want to, you know, respond to some of the questions that have been asked yesterday and today, which was really to imagine and to ask what if. Put yourself back in the mindset of a middle schooler or a high schooler. You know, you get to school, you had some breakfast, maybe you didn't have breakfast. Hurry up, the bell just rang. You know, you got a pencil, face front, be quiet. Now, you know, answer with a question I said. Now, oh, the bell just rang, hurry up, you got 4 minutes to get to the other place. Okay, you know, why are you in the hallway? Where's your pass? As a little bit of an aside, get to class is almost become like co-opted by the students as like a way of kind of identifying like that they're undermining the system. Like, yo, get to class. Like, it's like a way of like, you know, anyway, that's an interesting side. Yeah. And so if you really want to imagine, like, where do we get, because I feel like we're at two, and we do a lot of this. We do the student-teacher reset conversations, but, you know, having it happen after school, the logistics of that are really tough. Teachers have got to be in their classroom five periods a day. They've got one planning period. They're supposed to be planning. You know, the teachers at my building are really good about using that planning time for restoration, but that's not in their contract, you know, technically speaking. So if you want to ask, like, how do we get from two to, like, eight or nine, I would actually encourage you to, like, really break down the built environment. You know, think instead of, like, first period, second period, third period, and instead of first grade, second grade, third grade, imagine a more personalized approach to learning. Yep. Sometimes this is called competency-based education or personalized education, and it's very new, but it's very exciting. And I think it connects with restorative practices because it opens up that space. If a student is navigating a personalized pathway through their day, through their week, they might spend the first half hour of the day working independently on math. They might then join their reading group for a half hour. They might then meet with their mentor, who they meet with once a week. There's a couple of schools that are doing this really well. Lindsay Unified out of California. There's three individual schools in the Puget Sound area that are doing this, the Summit Charter Schools, or Summit Public Schools. They're a not-for-profit charter. And it's really exciting because, you know, if you think about breaking down the built space, like, then all of a sudden you do have the opportunities to bring together the three or four or five people that need to come together to respond to that harm. Right. If there was an argument before class and the teachers got in to break it up, somehow you have to now figure out a way to get five or six people together, maybe some parents on the phone, and it doesn't happen if you've got a six-period bell schedule. Yeah.
You know, we're almost out of time, and I want to give Ifrah the last word, but I do want to point out at this point that as we've been abstracting up from these programs on the ground to the ideas to sort of how to move forward in this, you can start to see that it's less about how we do school discipline and more about how schools themselves are constructed. And schools, for the most part, as institutions, don't work well for lots and lots of kids. They just don't. You know, it's worth pointing out at a conference like this that, you know, the founders were tutored at home. You know, homeschool often works for lots of people. So, Ifrah, I guess the last question I want to leave for you to answer or just to reflect on, if you would like, is, you know, given all the things we've talked about today, is, you know, what do you hope for your friends and your cohort in light of, you know, the stuff we've talked about today in this panel and in this conference? You know, what do you hope for, and what do you hope that those of us who are just a little bit older than you can help to do by paving the way for you all to lead?
Well, I think that I hope that my peers and my cohorts and adults, I hope that the youth get asked the right questions. I think that that is very critical, and that's what restorative justice does. It no longer asks you how you committed this offense. It asks you how does what you do affect those around you and yourself, right? That's a completely different how, but that question can completely break down the situation. And kids, youth like me, you know, are not used to being asked that question, right? Going through the standard education system, I'm always used to being asked, like, how you did this, right? Did you do it in this format? Like, did you do this after school? How did you put that glue on your teacher's table? Like, how did you do it, right? But you never ask, like, you never ask, like, why you did it. Or even if you ask why, it's very, like, primitive, you know? So just ask the right questions. And I think that when you ask the right questions, you build communications, you build relations, and everything else, like all the systematic things that are going on in the school system would just be all the right for it. So just ask the right questions.
I think that's a wonderful place to end.